José Marti was a Cuban patriot, freedom fighter, and poet. Although he never lived to see Cuba free, he is considered the national hero. He was born in Havana in 1853. He lived in a humble house on the street Bala. His parents were Maria Martina Navajo, who was from Spain, Leonor Pérez Cabrera, who was from the Canary Islands. José Marti was the oldest of seven sisters. At 9 years of age, he saw with his own eyes a Spanish man whipping a man of color, and since then began his desire for the independence of Cuba. When he was very young, his parents went with the family to Spain for a time, but soon returned to Cuba. Marti was a talented artist and enrolled in a school for painters and sculptors while still a teenager. Success as an artist eluded him, but he soon found another way to express himself, writing. At the age of 16, his poems and editorials were already being published in local newspapers. In 1869, Marti's writing got him in serious trouble for the first time. The 10 Years' War, an attempt by Cuban landowners to gain independence from Spain and free Cuban slaves, was being fought, and young Marti wrote passionately in support of the rebels. He was convicted of treason and sedition and sentenced to 6 years of labor. He was only 16 at the time. The chains in which he was held would scar his legs for the rest of his life. His parents intervened, and after 1 year, Marti's sentence was reduced, but he was exiled to Spain. While in Spain, Marti studied law, eventually graduating with a law degree and a specialty in civil rights. He continued to write, mostly about the deteriorating situation in Cuba. During this time, he needed two operations to correct the harm done to his legs by the shackles during his time in the Cuban prison. He traveled to France with his lifelong friend, Fermín Valdés Domínguez, who would also become an important figure in Cuba's quest for independence. In 1875, Martí went to Mexico, where he was reunited with his family. He was able to support himself as a writer in Mexico. He published several poems and translations, and even wrote a play, Amor con Amor se paga. In 1877, he returned to Cuba under an assumed name, but remained for less than a month before heading to Guatemala via Mexico. He quickly found work in Guatemala as a professor of literature in La Academia de Niños de Centro America, where he met María García Granado, a lovely 16-year-old girl known as La Niña de Guatemala. In his poem, José Martí wrote in her honor, "People say she died of love for José Martí. They both fell in love, but he was engaged to Carmen Sayas Bazán, who later became his wife, with whom he had a baby boy named José Francisco, known as Ismaelillo." Martí only remained in Guatemala for 1 year before resigning his position as professor in protest over the arbitrary firing of a fellow Cuban from the faculty. In 1878, José Martí returned to Cuba with his wife. He could not work as a lawyer as his papers were not in order, so he resumed teaching. He remained for only about a year before being accused of conspiring with others to overthrow Spanish rule in Cuba. He was once again exiled to Spain, although his wife and child remained in Cuba. He quickly made his way from Spain to New York City. Martí's years in New York City were very important. He kept very busy, serving as consul for Uruguay, Paraguay, and Argentina. He wrote for several newspapers, published both in New York and in several Latin American nations. It was during this time that he produced several small volumes of poetry, considered by experts to be the best poems of his career. He never surrendered his dream of a free Cuba, spending much time talking to fellow Cuban exiles in the city, trying to raise support for an independence movement. On June 30, his wife and son arrived in New York. After a short time in which Carmen Sayas Bazán realized that Martí's dedication to Cuban independence exceeded that of supporting his family, she returned to Havana with her son on August 27th. Martí would never see them again. The fact that his wife never shared the convictions central to his life was an enormous personal tragedy for Marti. He turned to comfort in Carmen Millares de Mantilla, a Venezuelan who ran a boarding school in New York. He is alleged to be the father of her daughter, Maria Mantilla. On January 5, 1892, Marti participated in a reunion of the emigration representatives in Cayo Hueso, the Cuban community of Key West, where the basis of Cuban Revolutionary Party was passed. He began the process of organizing the newly formed party. To raise support and collect funding for the independence movement, he visited tobacco factories, where he gave speeches to the workers and united them in the cause. In March 1892, the first edition of the Patria newspaper, connected to the Cuban Revolutionary Party, was published, funded, and directed by Marti with the help of General Máximo Gómez. On April 8, he was chosen delegate of the Cuban Revolutionary Party by the Cayo Hueso Club in Tampa and New York. From July to September 1892, he traveled through Florida, Washington, Philadelphia, Haiti, the Dominican Republic, and Jamaica on an organization mission among the exiled Cubans. On this mission, Marti made numerous speeches and visited various tobacco factories. In 1893, Marti traveled through the United States, Central America, and the West Indies, visiting different Cuban clubs. In July, he visited the President of the Mexican Republic, Porfirio Diaz, and traveled to Veracruz. In August, he prepared and organized the armed expedition that would begin the Cuban Revolution. Marti and Máximo Gómez declared the Manifesto de Monte Cristo, an exposition of the purposes and principles of the Cuban Revolution. Marti had convinced Gómez to lead an expedition to Cuba. Regardless of delays and desertions by some of the members, they got to Cuba. They landed at Playitas near Maicy Cape, Cuba on April 11th. Once there, they made contact with the Cuban rebels, who were headed by the Maceo brothers, and started fighting against the Spanish troops. By May 13th, the expedition reached Dos Rios. On May 19th, Gómez faced Jiménez de Sandoval's troops and ordered Marti to stay rear guard. But Marti separated from the majority of the Cuban forces and entered the Spanish lines. José Marti was killed in battle against Spanish troops at the Battle of Dos Rios. Marti was alone, and seeing a young messenger ride by, he said, "Joven, a la carga." This was around midday, and he was, as always, dressed in a black jacket, riding a white horse, which made him an easy target for the Spanish. The young messenger, Ángel de la Guardia, lost his horse, but returned to report the loss. Marti is buried in Cementerio Santa Efigenia in Santiago de Cuba. Many have argued that Maceo and others had always rejected Marti for never participating in combat. That may have forced Marti to that ill-fated suicidal two-man charge. Before leaving for Cuba, Marti wrote his literary will on April 1, 1895, leaving his personal papers and manuscripts to Gonzalo de Quesada, his friend and the Revolutionary Party secretary. He left him with instructions for editing his work. Knowing that the majority of his writing in newspapers in Honduras, Uruguay, and Chile would disappear over time, Marti instructed Quesada to arrange his papers in volumes. José Marti's lifelong dedication to the cause of Cuban independence and his passionate belief in democracy and justice has made him a hero for all Cubans, a symbol of unity, the apostle, a great leader. He is also considered one of the greatest Hispanic writers of all time.
Y antes de morir Herritage, mis versos del alma.